Every year, tickets for the San Diego Comic-Con downtown sell out in little over 1 hour. The Comic-Con Museum in Balboa Park allows visitors to experience part of the San Diego Comic-Con at any time during the year. The majority of the main floor focuses on the origins and methods of creating animation. First, let's take a look at the upstairs exhibit that highlights over 50 years of the Comic-Con International through its program cover art and publications. In 1970, the Golden State Comic-Con was held at the U.S. Grant Hotel in downtown San Diego. Here's the program cover featuring the California Tower in Balboa Park. Over the next two decades, it moved to other locations like the El Cortez Hotel just southwest of Balboa Park, the Sheraton Hotel on Harbor Island, Muir College on the west side of the UCSD campus, the structure that is now known as the San Diego Civic Theater, and finally, the San Diego Convention Center, where it has been held since 1991. The Comic-Con was originally created so fans of comic books could share their enthusiasm and interest in the medium. The first year was attended by 300 people and had a peak attendance of 167,000 people back in 2015. The focus expanded with each subsequent convention to include genres from science fiction, fantasy, film, and television. Costume play, also known as cosplay, is when fans dress up as their favorite characters from the comics, movies, or video games to show and share their appreciation with others in attendance. This is an added attraction for those who make the journey to the San Diego Convention Center, because not only will they see stars, previews, merchandise, and collectibles, but will also have an opportunity to view the different and often elaborate costumes worn by cosplayers. By the early 1990s, Comic-Con settled into the San Diego Convention Center and has been under threat of moving away from San Diego due to its ever-expanding footprint on the downtown area. To get a sense of how Comic-Con has spilled over into adjacent hotels and the Gaslamp Quarter, search for and watch the San Diego Review on Comic-Con International after this one. For San Diego, we hope the presence of the Comic-Con Museum here in Balboa Park shows the commitment of the organizers to have the convention remain in San Diego past the current contract, which lasts until 2024. This is the first appearance of the Comic-Con Toucan on the cover of a souvenir book. He's looking back at the Comic-Con eye we're familiar with. The eye adorns the right wall of the entryway to the museum. The information booth said the toucan statue, which used to be at the museum entrance, may be in storage or is being prepped for use at the Comic-Con itself. Like any good comic book, a movie must have a hero and must have a villain. Comic-Con is used to promote movies by presenting these characters to audiences in a way they can attend an event with the chance of seeing these superheroes or supervillains in person, or at least through fan cosplay. The panel discussions held for each movie generate excitement and allow actors and directors to share exclusive information and insight into how the movie was made and how the story arc of each character will progress. Along with the growth of the convention itself, Comic-Con has provided a place for people to trade or purchase merchandise associated with comics, shows, and games. The merchandise includes rare and collectible issues of comic books, vinyl toys and action figures, original artwork and limited edition pieces, accessories like wigs and masks for costumes, or t-shirts, hoodies, and hats related to favorite animated or film characters. In the far corner of the Comic-Con Museum is a triptych or three-panel drawing made by Sergio Aragones. It shows fans rushing from all parts of San Diego to the Comic-Con at the downtown convention center. The old location at the El Cortez Hotel has King Kong climbing the side. If you look closely at the lower right of the center panel, there's a pedicam pulling Aragonés along with writer Mark Evanier, who collaborated on the comic Gru the Wanderer. This was turned into the cover for the hardcover history of the San Diego Comic-Con after 40 years running up to that point. Comic-Con has continued in San Diego well past 40 years. 2023 will mark 54 years since it began. The current contract ensures it will be here at least until next year, and it's almost guaranteed San Diego will fight to secure its presence here for several more years. Although the pandemic disrupted Comic-Con, we hope it will retain its past from the El Cortez Hotel and rocket skyward into the future. In the downstairs portion of the museum are costumes on display. Every year, Comic-Con holds a masquerade event, which is similar to a costume contest, but adds the option of participants to include a performance for those in the audience. Entrants have staged fake battles, dance routines, or entertaining presentations complete with music and lighting effects. Trophies and cash prizes are awarded to the entries that appeal to the judges and audience. To learn more about some of these costumes and other exhibits at the Comic-Con Museum, search for and watch the San Diego Review on the Comic-Con Museum after this one. The theater downstairs shows a Looney Tunes clip with animation in its intended format as a motion picture. How is animation created? The Comic-Con Museum has its largest exhibit on the main floor and is called the Animation Academy. The entry to the exhibit gives a preview of what will be shown inside, like Gumby and the origins, process, and production to take still images or figurines and make them into animated characters telling a story. From Pencils to Pixels suggests the tools used in the art form of making animation and how they have evolved over the years. In 1908, this first hand-drawn animation cartoon was created in France by Emile Cole. It was called Phantasmagorie. The translation is Phantasmagoria, which stands for a sequence of real or imaginary images, like what we see in dreams. A phantasmagraph was a 19th century lantern used to project shadows of skeletons, demons, and ghosts onto walls. In this clip, we see a clown morphing through different shapes and situations. This was innovative for the time. Cole used a backlit light box to see the difference between frames while he drew the progression of images. He ended up with 700 drawings, exposing each to the camera twice, creating the fluid movement which marked the beginnings of animation. Flipbooks work on the same principle of flipping through still images rapidly to get a feeling of motion. Praxinoscopes have 12 mirrors arranged like a small cup, with images surrounding it. When the praxinoscope is rotated, each mirror selectively reflects the image before it into our eyes. This gives us the illusion of seeing motion in between images. Some of the early animated characters included Gertie the dinosaur, Felix the cat, Betty Boop, Popeye the Sailor Man, Mickey Mouse, and his rival Mortimer Mouse. Much later, Fred Flintstone and Yogi Bear were patterned after the personalities of Jackie Gleason and Art Carney from the Honeymooners TV show in the 1950s. Animated characters showed more depth, like the panicky antics of Shaggy and Scooby-Doo, or the nearsighted, oblivious optimism of Mr. Magoo. Animation lets us hear how characters sound. A boy named Gerald McBoingboing didn't speak with words, but with sound effects like this. It won an Academy Award for Best Animated Short, with Gerald McBoingboing finding his calling as a young Foley artist. In animation, there are 12 basic principles that are followed to make movement more realistic and believable. Three of them include squash and stretch, where a bouncing ball flattens upon hitting the ground and elongates when accelerating up or down. Anticipation is when a character is going to run off screen, they wind up their body in the opposite direction first. Slow in, slow out refers to how a swinging pendulum has more frames at the two endpoints, making the change in direction slower. A zoetrope is a cylinder with vertical slits used to view images printed on the interior. When the cylinder rotates, the slits permit us to see one image while blocking out the rest. The Animation Academy has the world's largest traveling zoetrope. In Greek, it translates as life turning. There are no vertical slits to block our vision, and we can clearly see each character in a slightly different pose. How does this one work? It will use a strobe light timed with the spin of the disc. If you're sensitive to strobe lights, look away for the next minute. The rotating 6-foot disc works with what's called persistence of vision, where each image we see stays in our eye long enough to connect it to the next one and the next, creating a fluid animation out of what would normally be a spinning blur if the lights were on constantly. From the bottom, we see Homer following the dog with a donut, while Bart skateboards through. Lisa spins as Felix the cat comes out of the ground with his magic bag. Gumby and Pokey walk by, while Marge chases Maggie rolling on a ball with Mr. Bill. The Pink Panther peeks over the wall at the center. As the lights come back on, we see the complete zoetrope. Traditional celluloid or hand-drawn animation was shot on an Oxbury stand like this one. The camera is suspended above and points down at the table where the background and cells are mounted. This setup allowed for movement of the table in conjunction with movements of the camera. A multi-plane down shooter had several tables mounted under the camera to create a layered or 3D effect. Rotoscoping is drawn by tracing over real-life footage frame by frame, and was used in Disney's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs to create realistic movements in the world's first full-length animated film. In the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, lunch boxes or lunch pails were produced with animated characters on the outside. They appealed to children and let them share their favorite cartoons or shows with their friends at lunchtime. Some of them came with matching insulated bottles for drinks or soup. Around the same years, Saturday mornings were filled with cartoons on the three major TV networks in the United States. They featured characters children could laugh at or relate to, like Porky Pig seen here. Or some of the other unsung heroes in Looney Tunes, who had secondary roles but were known for their memorable personalities. Hanna-Barbera had many cartoons that showed on Saturday mornings, like Scooby-Doo, The Flintstones, Yogi Bear, The Jetsons, Johnny Quest, and Space Ghost. Wacky Racers was a Hanna-Barbera series modeled after the 1965 movie The Great Race, and featured racing teams, each with their own distinctive vehicles. Saturday morning cartoons became a weekly ritual for families, but declined at the turn of the century due to availability of media through the internet. The Comic-Con Museum has a setup with characters from He-Man and the Masters of the Universe. This was the first animated show based on a toy series to reach syndication. By its second year, it was broadcast on 120 channels in the United States and over 30 countries around the world. Stop-motion animation is a painstaking process when compared to traditional hand-drawn or modern computer animation. Not only does every frame involve physically positioning the models or puppets being filmed, but the background and sets must be created, lighting and effects must be taken into consideration, and armatures and rigging must be designed to adjust the character models and allow for full movement throughout each scene. Some popular stop-motion films include The Nightmare Before Christmas, Fantastic Mr. Fox, Isle of Dogs, Coraline, and Guillermo del Toro's Pinocchio. The toys on the shelf point to the popular green clay stop-motion character Gumby from the 1950s. Gumby was the creation of a man who grew up as Arthur Farrington. While still a child, his parents divorced, and shortly thereafter he lost his guardian and birth father, Charles Farrington, in a car accident. Here's a picture of his birth father with a cowlick that caused his hair to stand up on one side. Arthur would later put the bump on Gumby's head as a tribute to him. Moving back in with his stepfather and mother, Arthur's stepfather didn't want to raise him and put him into a children's home. As fate would have it, Arthur was adopted by Joseph W. Clokey, a professor, organist, and composer who gave his adopted son the affection, security, and stability he needed in a world that had only given him sadness and grief in his young life. They went on summer adventures, painting, filming, and exploring the mountains and deserts in the West. They traveled to Mexico, Canada, Siberia, and Cuba. Art Clokey, as he is now famously known, drew upon these experiences and the endearment from his adopted father to create Gumby and its ensuing legacy. Many animators started while working under Art Clokey. Some went on to use their artistic talents in movies like Star Wars, Harry Potter, The Little Prince, James and the Giant Peach, and Kubo and the Two Strings. This exhibit shows an episode called Hidden Valley, where Gumby and Pokey drive an antique car into a land where dinosaurs still roam the earth. The car in this display is the actual one used in the show over 60 years ago. We can see Gumby filming several dinosaurs hiding among the trees. Gumby and other franchises of stop-motion animation have to take additional factors into consideration when creating their masterpieces. Clay models or maquettes help traditional two-dimensional animators see their characters from different angles. In claymation or stop-motion animation, these models are mounted on armatures, allowing them to be positioned and filmed. In traditional animation, like SpongeBob SquarePants, a character's facial expressions can be drawn by the animator. In stop-motion, a variety of heads or faces must be created, and then attached to the armature during each frame of the animation. 3D printing can be used to quickly manufacture head, mouth, and eye positions or expressions for stop-motion characters. Here are models of the pirates, with their finely detailed clothes and accessories. If we look close at their cheeks, we see the line where the different mouth positions can be attached to each character. Backgrounds for animated shows often go unnoticed, hiding behind the actions taken by the main characters in the foreground. They set the mood for what is occurring and can be familiar and comfortable, ominous and dangerous, or even whimsical and cheerful with an underwater pineapple. The background for stop-motion animation is a physical setup. creating a landscape which can be lighted and designed with items like the trees and gate, showing the interaction between this fox and tortoise. Notice that with a gradual change of lighting and sounds, the entire atmosphere of the set changes with it. It can go from dusk to the deep violet of twilight, complete with audible cues that come along with it. There are several places throughout the museum that permit visitors to try out their skills animating characters. Some involve using wooden kiva planks to build structures or buildings in the background, like this fairy tale castle. Others encourage children to draw on light tables to create cells from their favorite cartoons. A green screen has custom backgrounds that can be put behind guests. Or, if desired, there's the mystery machine from Scooby-Doo that makes everyone a part of the action. Termite Terrace was the nickname for an old building in Hollywood where Looney Tunes housed a team of creative people, not just to draw and animate the characters, but to write the scripts, pitch the stories, ink and paint everything, and photograph the cells and background. One exhibit shows the actual Royal typewriter used by Chuck Jones to write scripts for Looney Tunes. Another shows several voice and animation legends, including Mel Blanc, Tex Avery, and Fritz Freleng. In the Comic-Con Museum is an arcade console of Donkey Kong, which features Mario, who has become Nintendo's most popular character. Super Mario, Luigi, and their friends have become the number one franchise of Nintendo, gaining popularity over the last four decades. There have been numerous animated TV shows, and the most recent film, The Super Mario Bros. Movie, was released in 2023. The creation of Mario and the Donkey Kong video game came about because of another animated character. In 1929, Popeye the Sailor Man began appearing in the Thimble Theater comic strip in newspapers. His name came from his one squinty eye. He usually smoked a corncob pipe to show his rugged personality, and his way of talking reflected his working-class background. The creator of Popeye, L.C. Chrysler Seeger, met a sailor born in 1868 by the name of Frank Rocky Feigl, who served 20 years in the Merchant Marines and settled in Illinois. He was hired as a bouncer and was often involved in fights injuring his eye. He smoked a pipe and talked out of the side of his mouth. He served as the inspiration for Popeye. Popeye was added to the comic strip as a side character, but quickly became its main focus. Despite his rough persona, Popeye stood for honor, courage, and was willing to fight for justice. He was an everyday man who could become a superhero by eating his favorite food of spinach, which was not only nutritious, but gave him super strength. In the 1980s, Nintendo wanted to create a video game based on Popeye, Olive Oil, and Bluto, seeing them as an ideal fit for the struggle between good and evil. Due to licensing issues, Nintendo could not secure rights for Popeye, and came up with their own characters of Donkey Kong, Pauline, and Jumpman. This was a fortunate event for Nintendo, as Jumpman, later called Super Mario, would go on to drive their brand into the galaxy, with Super Nintendo Worlds opening in Japan, Hollywood, and two more planned in Singapore and Florida. As a side note, Nintendo eventually obtained rights to make a Popeye video game, but its success was far surpassed by Donkey Kong and Super Mario. Keymaster setups, or keyframes, have the characters drawn on cells with the matching background behind. They serve as reference points for animators to fill in what happens in between. Notice how the Simpsons' feet are missing, since they don't make it on camera anyway. To this end, animators have control of what we see. Look at this scene being shot for Carl Zeman's Journey to the Beginning of Time. Notice anything strange? How about now? Karel Zeman, seated here behind the camera, used a combination of stop motion and innovative techniques in the 1950s to make dinosaurs in the foreground appear to be as part of the background. It demonstrates a dedication to artistic expression, even though the method must have been meticulous and time-consuming. The Animation Academy at the Comic-Con Museum gives us an opportunity to see what goes into creating animations, from the origins of the characters to the story told by their dialogue and actions, along with the background, music, and sound effects that enhance what we see. The Comic-Con returns to San Diego in July, but once it's over, the Comic-Con Museum remains in Balboa Park for all to experience and enjoy throughout the year. If you enjoyed this video and all the original music, help this channel grow for free. Leave a comment below, click like, share this video and channel with others, and click the button to subscribe. Thanks for watching San Diego Review.